Welcome to the Permanent School of Ultrasound in Obstetrics and Gynecology, a comprehensive experience to learn the basics of our profession and important technical and methodological details about prenatal diagnosis. The philosophy of the school is to spread the scientific knowledge for its use in daily clinical practice and to teach 100% of our experience. In this following video, dedicated to the morphological examination of the fetus, I will present some technical and methodological tips that often are missing in common classical courses and that can help you in the evaluation of fetal anatomy. In fact, the specific aim of this lesson is not the diagnosis of fetal anomalies, but to give tools for the correct evaluation of fetal anatomy, that is, the indispensable prerequisite for the diagnosis of fetal anomalies. Thank you for watching. Before starting the fetal examination, I want to show you some standard echo planes suggested by the scientific community for the evaluation of fetal biometry and anatomy. Starting from the head, we can see the transthalamic plane, that is used for the measurement of biparietal diameter, occipitofrontal diameter, head circumference, and the cavities of the fetal cerebral ventricular system. On this plane, we can see many anatomical aspects of the brain, such as the thalami, the third ventricle, the cavum of the septum pellucidum, the cerebral falx, the lateral ventricles, the choroid plexus, and the insula. Tilting the transducer down and posteriorly, we can see the cerebral peduncles and the posterior fossa with its structures, such as the cerebellum, the cisterna magna with the Blake's pouch cyst, and the nuchal thickness. Straightening the probe and going a little down, we can see the eyes with the lenses. Looking at the thorax, we have to evaluate the lungs and the heart, with the four chambers view, right and left outflow tracts. At the level of the plane for the evaluation with the abdominal circumference, we can see the stomach, the liver, the portal sinus, the aorta, the inferior vena cava, and the adrenal glands. Going a little down, it is possible to see the cord insertion in the abdominal wall. Laterally, we can see the kidneys, and going down, the bladder with the two umbilical arteries, and finally the fetal sac. Other important scanning planes are related with the evaluation of the spine in the three orthogonal planes, the facial profile, the lips and nose, all the long bones such as humerus, ulna and radio, femur, tibia and fibula, and the extremities, hands and feet. Before starting, it is very important to consider some key aspects. For example, to put the patient in the right position. That should be supine with the back fully extended, lowering the backrest of the bed. We can use a pillow under the neck to reduce the possible discomfort. This position will reduce the thickness of the abdominal wall and will improve the visibility of the fetal structures. The second step is the choice of the probe and its presence in relation with some issues like the gestational age, the aim of the ultrasound examination. For example, it will be different if you have to examine the fetal heart instead of the brain or abdominal organs, the habitus of the patient, the thickness of her abdominal wall. I usually prefer to press the machine with high contrast and fast frame rate. That's the reason why, when possible, and particularly when the abdominal wall is thin, I choose a probe with high frequency. I reduce the ultrasound beam to the region of interest. This will increase the frame rate. I choose a gray map with high contrast. I select a color scale like the sepia because the human eye is more sensitive to the color instead of the simple gray scale, and generally I select a high dynamic range in order to increase the contrast, and finally, very important, I put the focus in the precise region of interest. Scanning the fetus, I suggest to follow a kind of mental scheme for the visualization of fetal anatomy, but to save time, I suggest to search for what is achievable and what is viewable by the ultrasound beam depending on fetal position. Starting the examination, the first step is the recognition of fetal line and position, and the recognition of which of fetal parts or organs are easily achievable by the ultrasound beam. In this case, you can see that the fetus is cephalic with a spine on the right. So generally, one of my priorities is to check if the heart is achievable by the ultrasound beam. As you can see, in this case, the heart is clearly visible and I start the examination with this organ. Before starting the heart evaluation, I want to show you some theoretical aspects. As you can see, there are many suggested scanning planes for the fetal heart. The four chambers view is absolutely the most important. A very good examination of this view will let you to recognize the majority of fetal heart anomalies, but it isn't enough, and we must be able to obtain the other scanning planes that I underlined in yellow, and particularly the left and right outflow tracts, the three vessels and trachea view, the aortic and ductal arch, and the vena cava view. So, what should be considered in the four-chamber view? The heart is to the left of the chest with the apex pointing at about 45 degrees forward and to the left. The heart is above the diaphragm and there are no other abnormal structures in the chest, such as the stomach, for example. The area occupied by the heart is about a third of that of the thorax. Both the ventricles and the atria are present and have approximately equal size. The left ventricle occupies the apex of the heart. The moderator band is visible toward the apex of the right ventricle. The intraventricular and interatrial septa are present and they appear intact. For the interatrial septum, we have to evaluate the foramen ovale with the septum primum freely floating into the left atrium. The atrioventricular valves are present and appear normal, with a slight displacement of the medial edge of the tricuspid valve toward the apex. The presence and disposition of the pulmonary veins. There is no pericardial pleural effusion. And finally, another structure which is not strictly visible in the four-chamber view, but very close to it, is the coronary sinus, that I included in this list because its visualization is very easy and important. In fact, the sinus is easily visible over the mitral valve going from the four-chamber view a little bit down to the posterior wall of the fetal heart, reminding that the fetal heart is horizontal. The visualization of this vessel is very important in some situations to identify the left side of the heart, for example, in some isomerisms, when it isn't clear which is the right and the left side of the heart. In this short scene loop, we will try to visualize all the structures of the fetal heart that we mentioned before in the previous slide. First of all, you can see over the mitral valve the coronary sinus going into the right atrium. The atrioventricular valves are present and appear normal, with all the leaflets moving freely into the ventricles. The slight displacement of the middle edge of the tricuspid valve toward the apex. The aspect and dimension of the ventricles that have approximately equal size, with the left ventricle forming the apex of the heart and with the right ventricle under the sternum with the moderator band. We can see the atria that approximately have equal size, with the foramen ovale and the septum primum freely floating into the left atrium. We can see the two inferior pulmonary veins going into the left atrium, with the thoracic aorta placed very close and posteriorly to the left atrium. As I told you, it is well known the importance of the four-chamber view in the diagnosis of fetal heart anomalies. And here you can see the main pathologies that is possible to see in the four-chamber view, particularly the ectopia cordis, the ventricular hypoplasia, the single ventricles, cardiomegaly and or hypertrophy, large interatrial and intraventricular defects, valvular atresis, cardiac dislocations, pericardial effusions, Epstein anomaly, and cardiac tumors. But as you can see here, there are some pathologies that represent a real challenge in prenatal diagnosis that are not diagnosable in the four-chamber view, and particularly the tetralogy of Fallot, the transposition of great arteries, truncus arteriosus, the double outlet ventricles, stenosis or atresia of the aortic valve and of the pulmonary valve, and aortic arch anomalies, such as coartation, interruption, the presence of right aortic arch or the double aortic arch. So, to make the diagnosis of some very important fetal heart pathologies, we need more than four-chamber view. And here, in this session, I will show you the methodology to reach some other very important cardiac views, and particularly how to get the left, right, outflow tracts and the trivessel and trachea view starting from the four-chamber view. In this schema, you can see that there is a very simple movement, and particularly tilt the transducer toward the fetal head, and with this simple movement you can reach these very important cardiac views. Here I will show you the methodology to get the left outflow tract starting from the four-chamber view. You can see here in red is represented the ultrasound beam. You must remember that the heart in the fetus is in horizontal position. To get this view, you have to put the transducer perpendicularly to the fetal body. To get the left outflow tract, as I told you, you have to tilt the transducer toward the fetal head and slightly rotate to the right shoulder of the fetus. Here I will show you the movement to improve to the transducer. Tilt and rotate a little bit to the right shoulder of the fetus, and here you can see the left outflow tract with the continuity between the intraventricular septum and the ascending aorta. Here is the aortic valve. The mitral valve now is opening during diastole, and with the systole, the mitral valve is closed and the aortic valve is open. To get the right outflow tract, starting again from the four-chamber view, you have to tilt the transducer toward the fetal head a little bit more than before, but you have to rotate the transducer to the left fetal shoulder. And here I will show you the methodology. Tilt, but in this case rotate to the left fetal shoulder of the fetus. And here you can see the right outflow tract. Here you can see the scheme of action to get the outflow tract. Again, four chamber view, the ultrasound beam is perpendicular. For the left outflow tract, tilt and rotate to the right shoulder. To get the right outflow tract, tilt a little bit more and rotate to the left shoulder. Here is the checklist for the great vessels. You must evaluate that the aorta is arising from the left ventricle, the pulmonary artery from the right ventricle. You have to check that these two vessels are crossing. You have to see that there are no ventricular septal defects, particularly the membranous defect, and look to the alignment in order to exclude some pathology, like, for example, the tetralogy of Fallot. The pulmonary artery and the aorta have approximately equal sides, with the pulmonary artery, pulmonary trunk, little bit bigger than the aorta, with the ratio 1.2 to 1. You have to check the continuity of the vessels and the disposition of the vessels. Particularly, the pulmonary trunk and the ductus arteriosus, you can see here, and the aorta should be on the left, with the trachea to the right. And you have to check the number of the vessels: 1, pulmonary, 2, aorta, and superior vena cava. No more vessels than these three vessels. And here is the trachea. Now we know how to get the right and left outflow tracts. Here I will show you the methodology to get the three vessel and trachea view. I suggest to start from the right outflow tract view. From this view, we have to tilt the transducer a little bit more, and we can see the three vessel and trachea view. Here you can see practically how you can get the three vessel and trachea view starting from the right outflow tract. You have to tilt the transducer a little bit more, and you have to reduce the rotation to the left shoulder, like here. And you can see the three vessel and trachea view. Here you can see the scheme of action in order to get the three vessel and trachea view. As I said, you have to tilt the transducer. I told you how to rotate the transducer in order to get the right and left outflow tract, so we can start from four chamber view, getting the right outflow tract, and to get the three vessel and trachea view, as I told you, you have to tilt a little bit more and reduce a little bit the rotation to the left fetal shoulder. Magnifying the picture of the hands movement, we can see the methodology to get these views. Tilting the transducer, rotating to the right shoulder, and you will get the left outflow tract. Look at the movement, they're very little. Starting from the four chamber view, you have to tilt for the fetal head, rotate to the left shoulder a little bit more inclination than before, and you will get the right outflow tract. To get the three vessel and trachea view, you have to tilt a little bit more again, and to slightly reduce the rotation to the left shoulder of the fetus. You can see these movements are very little, but it is very important that you understand the methodology. So here you can see the checklist for the three vessel and trachea view. As I told you, we have to check the number of the vessel, must be three, the pulmonary trunk, ductus arteriosus, and the aorta with the isthmus. So pulmonary, aorta, superior vena cava, trachea here, and just in front and over the fetal heart, you can see the thymus is a little bit less echoic than the lungs. And in this view, you have to check the number, as I told you, the disposition of the vessel, as I told you, the pulmonary trunk, ductus arteriosus, and the aorta must be on the left with the trachea and the superior vena cava on the right, like you can see here. The dimension appearance of the vessel, as I told you, the pulmonary artery is a little bit bigger than the aorta with the ratio 1.2 to 1, and the duration of the vessel flow. This is very important. When you check the heart, and particularly this this view, the trivessel and trachea view, you have to check this view with the Doppler, with color Doppler, in order to see the direction of the flow that must be in the same direction. Now we are able to see many aspects of the fetal heart, but if we want to have more, we have to do the examination of the ductal arch and the aortic arch. And I suggest to start from the trivessel and trachea view. Particularly, when you are in the trivessel and trachea view, in order to get the ductal arch, you have to align the ultrasound beam with the pulmonary artery, and after that you have to rotate the transducer 90 degrees in order to get the ductal view. For the aorta, starting from the trivessel and trachea view, you have to align the ultrasound beam with the aorta, and after that you have to turn the transducer on 90 degrees and you will get the aortic arch view. Starting from the trivessel and trachea view, alignment with the pulmonary artery, 90 degree rotation, and we will get the ductal arch view. To get the aortic arch view, align the ultrasound beam with the aorta, moving the transducer more to the right shoulder of the fetus, rotating the transducer 90 degrees, and here you can see the aortic arch. Here you can see the scheme of action to get the ductal arch from the trivessel and trachea view. Align the ultrasound beam, moving the transducer to the right shoulder, and you will align the ultrasound beam with the pulmonary artery. After that, you have to rotate the transducer on 90 degrees in this way, and here is the view of the ductal arch. For the aortic arch, as I told you, you have to make the alignment with the aorta, moving the transducer to the right shoulder. When you are in this condition, with perfect alignment with the aortic arch, you have to turn the transducer on 90 degrees, as you can see here, and you will get the aortic arch view. When we are examining the fetal heart, and particularly when we are visualizing the aortic arch moving a little bit more to the right shoulder of the fetus, we have to evaluate the right venous return with the visualization of the two vene cave going into the right atrium, the so-called vene cave view. I want to tell you that evaluating the fetal heart, it is always important to use color, because it will increase the information that we can get from the examination, helping us in the evaluation of the structure and the function of the heart, increasing our possibility to evaluate the physiology or pathophysiology in case of fetal heart anomalies. The extended use of Doppler is a part of the echocardiography, which is not the aim of this lesson, but here I want to underline that the use of color Doppler can help us in the evaluation of some heart structures, such as the integrity of the intraventricular septum. To do that, I have to increase the angle of intonation between the septum and the ultrasound beam, and I have to look for color overlap across the septum. By color, the interventricular septal defects generally are seen with the phenomenon called aliasing, which is due to the high velocity of the blood throughout the defect, and it is seen in yellow like a little flame. As you can see, after the septum, I'm going to see the atrioventricular valves, changing the angle of intonation in the way to maximize the Doppler effect, reducing the angle between the blood flow and the ultrasound beam. In this way, it is possible to evaluate the functionality of the valves and, for example, their continence or the presence of a reflux during the ventricular systole. As you can see here, there is a little regurgitation across the tricuspid valve. During the fetal life, some little regurgitation are paraphysiologic due to the functional immaturity of the valve, and they are particularly present across the tricuspid valve. This kind of little regurgitation must be inferior to 70 milliseconds, or easier, inferior to the half of the ventricular systole, with a velocity inferior to 90 cm per second. Here, for example, from the velocity waveform profile, we can see that this regurgitation is very little without any clinical significance. Examining the heart, we have to remember to recognize many other thoracic organs. Here, for example, you can see the thymus that is located just in front and superiorly to the heart. You can see it's less echogenic than the lungs. You can see here in longitudinal plane and in transverse plane. It's very easy to identify, particularly in the trivessel and trachea view, just below the sternum. Here you can see the trachea, starting from the trivessel view, going down, you can see the two main bronchi. You see here the two main branches of the pulmonary artery, the left and the right, and here the two main bronchi. The confluence in the trachea, going longitudinally, we can see the terminal portion of the trachea and the end of the trachea just below the aortic arch. Again, you can see in transverse view the two main bronchi. Going longitudinally, we can follow the upper segments of the trachea, starting from the fetal pharynx. You can see the epiglottis, and going down, we can follow all the segments of the trachea and the end just below the aortic arch. Another fetal organ that sometimes is possible to see is the esophagus. You can see is very thin with the hyperechoic walls, is going down and anteriorly, and we can follow tilting the transducer all segments, starting from the pharynx, going down till the insertion into the stomach. Look at the beginning here, just below the trachea, and tilting down, you can follow all segments, and at the end you have to tilt a little bit on the left side in order to see the insertion into the stomach. After the evaluation of the thoracic organs, in relation with the position of the fetus and with the possibility of visualization of the other fetal organs, we can move to the abdomen. Here you can see the left kidney and the relative adrenal gland very close to the stomach, the liver with the diaphragm that separates the liver from the left lung, the heart and the right lung. Turning the probe to the transverse plane, we can recognize the correct view for the measurement of the abdominal circumference with a visualization of the relative landmarks such as the adrenal glands, The J sign realized by the intrahepatic portion of the umbilical vein and the portal sinus, the stomach, the inferior vena cava, and the abdominal aorta. To be sure that this is the correct plane, we have to recognize all these landmarks and to avoid the visualization of the kidneys and the latest portion of the umbilical vein close to the umbilicus. As I told you, generally we should follow a kind of meta scheme for the visualization of fetal anatomy, but to save time, I suggest to search before for what is achievable by the ultrasound beam in relation to fetal position in each moment of your scanning time. Here, for example, you can see that the head is deflected and it is not possible its evaluation, so I move to the face that is just under the probe. Going down, we can see the maxillar bone and we can try to evaluate the integrity of the palate. To do that, we have to see the integrity of the posterior margin of the palate bone, because the cleft eventually present generally starts posteriorly, and it is visible, like here, as an hyperechoic border with two little arches. You can see the pharynx, and tilting the probe, you can see very clearly, just behind the tongue, the posterior margin of the palate bone, like two little arches. Moving along the sagittal plane, we can see the facial profile with the lips and the nose. In order to exclude the presence of macrognathia, we must remember that the ideal line that connects the tip of the nose and the tip of the chin should touch the tips of the lips. In this favorable fetal position, it is possible to observe the eye's details, such as the fibrotic ring of the oculomotor muscles and, behind the eyeball, the optic nerve of both sides. Here is clearly visible the fibrotic ring and the optic nerve, and on the other side the optic nerve and the fibrotic ring for the oculomotor muscle insertion. In the sagittal view, just above the tongue, it is possible to see the soft palate and the uvula. This is a further sign of palate integrity. The uvula is particularly visible, as here, when the tongue is moving. If we tilt the transducer down, it is possible to see the hard palate. Because of the deflected fetal head, we left out the examination of the fetal head that now is clearly visible, and getting the transthalamic view, it is possible to examine the cephalic biometry and brain anatomy. In this view, the orbits and the structures of the posterior fossa are not visible, but it is possible to see the cerebral fax, the thalami, the anterior and posterior horns of the lateral ventricles, and the cavum of the septum pellucidum, the choroid plexus, the insula, and the smooth cerebral cortex of the hemispheres. This is the correct view to get some biometric parameters, like the head circumference, biparietal diameter, and occipital frontal diameter. All these measurements must be taken from outside, except for the PPD, that is obtained by placing the calipers from outside the proximal portion to inside the distal portion of the skull, as shown here. Tilting the transducer down and posteriorly, we can try to examine the posterior fossa that, in this moment, is not clearly achievable. For that reason, I decide to perform the TUI, the tomographic ultrasound imaging, that allows to get the whole fetal brain with all cerebral structures. In this way, it is possible to navigate through the whole fetal brain, getting every section that is more suitable for the evaluation of fetal anatomy. In this way, it is possible to get virtual sections, like here the sagittal sections and particularly the medial sagittal section, looking at some brain structures that otherwise in this moment are impossible to get, such as the cavum of septum pellucidum, the medial face of the thalamus, the third ventricle, the sylvian aqueduct, the fourth ventricle, and the integrity of the wall cerebral vermis. Now, the transcerebellar view is easily achievable, and it is possible to see the posterior inferior portion of the thalami, the cerebral peduncles, and the posterior fossa, evaluating its structures, the wall cerebellum with the vermis and hemispheres, the cisterna magna with the Blake pouch cyst, and the nuchal thickness. As you can see, the nuchal thickness must be measured from outside the occipital bone to outside the occipital skin. So in this slide, it is possible to see two of the most important views for the evaluation of the fetal brain, the transthalamic plane and the transcerebellar plane, and how we have to move the probe from the first to the second plane, tilting down and posteriorly. Again, getting the transthalamic view, it is possible to examine the cephalic biometry and the brain anatomy. In this view, it is possible to see the cerebral falx, the thalami, the anterior and posterior horns on the lateral ventricles, the cavum of the septum pellucidum, the choroid plexus, the insula, and the smooth cerebral cortex. As I told you, this is the correct view to get some biometric parameters, like the head circumference, biparietal diameter, and occipital frontal diameter. All these measurements must be taken from outside, except for the BPD, that is obtained by placing the calipers from outside the proximal skull to inside the distal skull, as shown here. With the transcerebellar view, it is possible to see the posterior inferior portion of the thalami, the cerebral peduncles, and the posterior fossa, evaluating its structures, the wall cerebellum with the vermis and hemispheres, the cisterna magna with the Blake pouch cyst, and the nuchal thickness. As you can see, the nuchal thickness must be measured from outside the occipital bone to outside the occipital skin. When possible directly, or as I shown you with the here represented TUI technology, it is very important to get the medial sagittal view for the evaluation of some crucial anatomical structures, such as the cavum of the septum pellucidum, the medial face of the thalami with the third ventricle, the sylvian aqueduct, the fourth ventricle, the wall cerebral vermis, the cisterna magna, and the pontine structures of the cerebral trunk. Here you can see highlighted the cerebral structures that I have just described. Sometimes it is possible to get directly the medial sagittal view, and it is possible to look at the same structures just described. In this way, it is very easy to recognize the corpus callosum with all its portions. Thanks to the favorable position of the fetal face surrounded by the amniotic fluid, I tried to do the rendering of the surface with a new technology, HD Live, and it is very easy and fast to evaluate the details of the fetal face using the virtual lighting, as you can see here. Because of the fetal unfavorable position, we left out the examination of some cephalic structures that in this moment are visible, such as the coronal view of the face, looking at the tip of the nose with the nostrils, the superior and inferior lips, and the chin. In this way, we can exclude not only, as shown before, the palatoschisis, but also the labioschisis. Another important step in the assessment of fetal anatomy is the evaluation of all segments of the fetal spine. As you can see, it is possible also to recognize the medulla and its meninges from the cephalic structures to the conus medullaris that reaches the second lumbar vertebral body and that continues as a cauda equina that is not sonographically visible. If available, we can use the 3D reconstruction that helps us in detecting the different parts of the fetal spine and the ribs. Remember to evaluate the presence and regularity of the sacrum between the iliac bones in order to exclude sacral agenesis. Evaluating the fetal back, we must remember to examine the kidneys, tilting the transducer downwards in order to exclude the ribs shadow. Choosing this view, it is possible to avoid the shadow of the ribs and to obtain a very good visualization of these organs. If available, also here we can use the volume technology, and particularly we can use the TUI, tomographic ultrasound imaging, that helps us not only in the evaluation but also in the documentation of the presence and regularity of both kidneys navigating through the anatomical structures. As you can see here, before starting the TUI acquisition, it is important to put the probe just in the middle of the posterior transverse section in order to exclude the shadow of the spine. Now we can evaluate the presence and regularity of all fetal extremities. Here you can see that even the fetus is actively moving, like here, tilting the probe. We can evaluate the whole fetus anatomy, and particularly it is very easy to exclude any sign of clubfoot. As a rule, we must remember that when it is possible to see the sole of the feet, should be impossible to see contemporarily the tibia and fibula, and vice versa. When possible, and when it is available the 3D technology, we can obtain a surface reconstruction of the feet and to recognize very easily these aspects. But at the same time, it is important to underline that it is not essential to use this kind of technology, even if it is largely available today. Looking at the superior extremities, it is very important to remember that the thumb is located in a different plane than the other four fingers, and if the fingers are not extended, like here, we have to tilt the transducer for the recognition of all the fingers. Obviously, also here, when available, it is possible to use the 3D technology. We must not forget other very important fetal structures, like the bladder, with the two umbilical arteries that rise from the iliac vessels to the umbilicus. As you can see, here we can recognize the labia of the fetal genitalia, because this fetus is a girl, and the anal sphincter. We can use color Doppler for an easier identification of the umbilical arteries beside the bladder, and turning the probe longitudinally, it is possible to follow its course to the emergence from the umbilicus. This view is very important because allows us to exclude some abdominal wall defects like gastroschisis and omphalocele. Therefore, we can proceed with the biometric evaluation of the long bones, remembering to visualize always such structures with a small angle of intonation. Being greater the axial than the longitudinal resolution, this will enable us to have a good visualization of the bones, including its extremities, making the measurement easier and more accurate, and letting us to exclude the periosteum in the measurement. For a better documentation, when possible, I try to include all the limbs segments in the same picture. In this case, you can see the pronation of the fetal forearm and the impossibility to include all the three bones in the same picture. So I proceed to evaluate the ulna before and the radius laterally. As you can see, for the inferior limb, it is much easier to include the three bones in the same picture, because obviously in this limb there aren't problems of pronation. Again, remember to exclude the periosteum in the measurement of the long bones and to evaluate the anatomy of all the four limbs. This is very important in order to exclude the absence or the abnormality of all segments of the all fetal limbs. We can conclude our examination with the evaluation of uterine hemodynamics that give us information about placental perfusion. This evaluation is very easy and is not time consuming. We have to identify the uterine ileum, laterally and perpendicularly to the uterus, and with the help of the color, it is very easy to identify the uterine artery crossing the iliac vessel. Choosing a good angle of intonation, that generally must be inferior to 30 degrees, and adjusting the PRF, we can obtain a good uterine artery waveform profile. Here you can see a good uterine perfusion with high diastolic velocity and the absence of the protodiastolic notch from both right and left sides. With these last images, I want to thank you for your interest, reminding that what we have seen in this video is much more than requested for the standard screening examination, but surely it can help us in realizing a correct approach in the evaluation of fetal anatomy, that is the prerogative for the diagnosis of fetal anomalies. Thank you for watching. Thank you.